Well, the last talk was a bit text based. Bob was asked for having some drawings, and coincidentally, I prepared some slides with drawings. So my next topic is visualizing network architectures, drawing it, and well, let's speak about our challenge, what we have to do, our tools, and how to do it. You remember, networks are very complex with thousands of phones and TVs and mobiles and cameras and hundreds of subnets, all is routed and interfacing each other and secured in zones. We have to visualize it, to understand it, and to explain it somehow. And we have to do it for a lot of ships. And I don't want to do it manually all the time. So I use TEC for it. And PGF, TIGS. You saw TIGS already a bit in the last talk. I don't want to talk much about it. You know it, it's a graphics package which is very capable, very readable, and has a excellent documentation. And that's why I use it, especially for its readability. When I started to make network drawings, I draw with TIGS symbols myself. With TIGS you got arrows and shadings and so on, but it turns out it's a bit laborious for building a bigger library. So I simply use manufacturer icons. Manufacturers like Cisco, they provide big libraries of clip arts or PostScript images or visual stencils. I decided to use PostScript images to convert them via scripts, the whole library, to small PDF files, use them as PDF images via input graphics, make a TIGS node style that includes the image, so every device type has its node style. They look like this, so I produce the same drawings looking the same like in network training books, like in Cisco documentation. So that makes it quick and easy. I have 100 symbols. So you saw it in the last talk. This has to be put to a drawing somehow. When we test together with the customer, he wants to understand the cabling, the networking, what is what in this pile of switches, functions. So we usually need drawing for physical connections, for switching, for bundles of channels, for logical network structure for each subsystem, like for telephony or CCTV or TV infotainment internet connections. We need routing diagrams and a visual security concept to understand what interfaces with what. And that's a sample of a routing between just two devices. This is actually one core switch and one firewall, and the core switch has virtual switches inside and the firewall has virtual routers inside, and those two devices route between the networks sometimes in a complicated way. And for testing, for explaining and discussing network structure, for tracing routes from host to the internet, I use this drawing also to test each gateway reachability. And this same kind of routing I had to do for several ships. Very equivalent, just the IP addresses change. Even the VLAN numbers, network numbers are the same, but different IP addresses. So I simply recalculate and regenerate the drawing. And yeah, I have to repeat this for some ships. Those here are some management addresses, and next ship has different management addresses. They are the same, just placed in another network. So I change a base address, and the drawing is current and right. For my images, I define styles for everything. If you do a first drawing and a second, maybe you do some things manually, and then you notice you have to repeat things again and again, and then you decide to change something, you have to change it everywhere. So you, at some stage, you are convinced to use styles and use styles based on styles. So inherit things. Here you can see I have a simple image style with a ticks path picture, including my small icon graphic. I have a switch style, including specifying the file name of the switch and some size. Of course, I have those styles, a style for a firewall, a style for a router, a style for a server, and so on. And they just have the name. Server, the style. Also for links, I define a basic client style, a channel style, which is then inherited for another more complex style, maybe with different colors. This channel style, for example, is a double line, which helps in seeing crossing lines, because I will show it later in the picture. I have a basic arc style for my channel bundles. I have small arcs and bigger arcs, and so I have a base arc style and further styles. You see how they are applied. In the middle, it's like I draw a line from core 1 to core 2 in the style channel. It's simple and readable in a very expressive language. Even not very tech or tech savvy people can work with it. They understand it, it's written human readable, and they can make changes, like changing labels. I'm not available to adjust the drawing. Yeah, this is how it looks like when I use names for everything. I name coordinates, I name each node, and position relative between nodes. And you see how the styles are applied. Here I just change the style to have physical hardware pictures, photographs for a physical drawing. Changing symbols or to photos is just changing the style and regenerate the whole picture, either in such a format, in a logic or a physical format. And of course I don't like to repeat things again and again, typing. I use for each loops or multi-part nodes to simplify work. You can see the channel style. Let's zoom a bit in. When lines are crossing, I want to have a gap, and I draw one part of such an arc in the foreground and one in the background, and you see nicely crossing lines. This requires also some styles and some programming, parameterizing those loop symbols. And it's too much work for me to do it in Visio or to adjust it. I just want to have it logically from point to point, and want to be able to change the whole drawing, and everything goes to the new position, and the edges still stay in the labeling. I may have to turn something, but it's still all connected in the same way. Yeah, this is how typical loops look like. It's not looking easy anymore, like the basic TIX language, but at some time you want to show also challenging things to show competence. But once you understand how for each loops work, it's just typing quickly a loop instead of repeating something. And you see, I use macros and names for constants, for the four dimensions. So I just change some constants, some constants in a header file, and my whole drawing changes. Distances between core switches or between small switches. I recompile and have an adjusted drawing. Once I got my structure and my construction elements, I can put it easily together to a similar drawing, or use it as a template and put in different labels for different purposes. At some time I want to show and discuss bandwidth things, or show port connections, point-to-point connection, or IP addressing. So I have similar pictures. Here you can see this really bags for macros. It's looking all the same, just different naming and port channel numbers. This is the ship in vertical fire zones and horizontal decks. Distribution switches put into the ship at a certain position with their IP addresses and their names. And this is simply a TIX matrix, and the graphic is a macro with some parameters. And for each subsystem, I generate again a drawing and put in some additional devices to see, hey, those are my phones, my gateways, my voice servers, and are the IP addresses and their VLANs to hand out to the specialist who works with it. This is your place in the network, this is your data. You can focus on your part, and everybody gets his part, his drawing. Besides calculating, I also use the FIT library to put some rectangles around something. It's TIX does automatic fitting to nodes, so I simply say, hey, make a rectangle around this and this node, or this cloud of nodes, to summarize things. Another setup showing switch connections. My layer 2 setup, which I then can improve to be a routing drawing, showing where my routing goes to with TIX styles for arrows with subnets, for explaining how it technically works, what we set up, what all those hardware does. Again, I used in the same concept fitting and filling the fitted rectangles with a background color behind the switches, to show a security concept, the various zones, and had a style for the colored edges. And as I said, sometimes the customer or my boss wants to have a vertical version or a visual version, and I was asked how to deal with it. I experimented a bit. Microsoft Visio is kind of a standard for network drawings, at least for the people I know, and so I have to see what Visio can work with. Unfortunately, I think no Microsoft product can import PDF files, maybe on purpose. Of course, no PostScript or DBI, so I have to convert to another format which Microsoft Visio can import. I tried DVG, AutoCAD, the shapes were very bad, were just thick and black and not looking good. I tried SVG, this actually SVG works very fine with DVI SVGM driver, for which I can use with PGF. I used Inkscape. It has a command line converter for converting PDF to SVG. I go the way from PDF and not from TIX directly. I heard from Till Tantor, he wants to give a native support for SVG for PGF and TIX. So this would be a more direct way to create SVG with animation capability. Yes, but SVG doesn't work for Microsoft Visio. While a browser displays the SVG export fine, Visio just shows some black nodes, some good nodes, but rotated, it's a bit crazy. I wasn't able to use it, so it turned out I used Windows Meta file format to export to Visio. It gives the perfect result, but just a single object, not partial objects, but it's scalable. I can put it into Visio drawing, annotate it, and my boss is satisfied and lets me use text still. So in industry and production, you have to be fast and efficient. So I set up my tools in an efficient way. I use styles and inheritance and heavily macros and constants and name everything, use relative positioning and loops and let TIX do the calculations for me, middle points, end or beginning positions. So I just tweak small points or macro content to adjust the whole drawing and to reuse drawing for the next project. Thanks.
More questions for Stefan?
Did you test exporting to SVG with DVI SVGM images that contain text labels? And if so, did they display well on the browser?
My DVI SVG test. It didn't work, and I quickly changed to Inkscape just to see if it works at all before fiddling more with SVG. And as it turned out, it looked bad in Visio. I did not follow the path SVG anymore for the moment, but for the future, Inkscape also provides several types of SVG, and that's why I tested the Inkscape own SVG format, a generic SVG format, and optimized compressed formats. Maybe at some time I find the best way for SVG to work in Visio. As browsers were not my destination, I did not test SVG, DVI SVG with browsers.
When you go from project to project, how much work can you reuse and save? 30%, 50, 40, just approximate how much work can you reuse for drawings?
If it's the same type of ship,
yeah.
I reuse all the drawings and just change the names. The ship name, the macro for the ship name on my frame. You know, there's a frame around it showing version number and the customer name, the ship's name. Mm-hmm. So I adjust some names, I adjust IP addresses, and use the same drawing again. Some cruise companies, they build one ship every year, 4, 5, 6, 7 ships. So I have the same drawings everywhere, and just a different content in the labels. And it took me a lot of days, of course, to produce those drawings. But for one ship, for the first ship of its generation, but for the second ship, it took me a few hours to make it all fine and to show it to the customer in a very early stage, kind of finished documentation. And that was very impressive for him. Usually you get the documentation after the end, or you even have to wait weeks or months until somebody delivers documentation, and if you see it already all in the beginning, it makes a good professional impression here.
I'm imagining you must play the procedure, but one thing is the whole configuration is in an ASCII file. If I accidentally do some search and replacement during editing, the whole configuration files may get damaged. So I should take extra care, I think. Care means these are all network data are very sensitive. So my suggestion is if the input part is put in a database or something, or interface is there to edit the data. And another program can type out all these tech files. The data maintenance will be much safe.
Can you repeat this? That's
the when you edit the in the text editor, tell me if I'm getting this right. In the text editor, you do the wrong search and replace your screen. In short.
Well, you have to care for backups all the time. And in any case, you need a versioning system or a backup system. We have a documentation wiki where we upload all files and different stages. I make my own backups. And you only make the mistake one time to not have a backup.
Carl, can I add this one? Stefan, I'm very interested in this because I think you and I share a lot of commonalities on workflows. When Rajagopal mentioned that, I've advocated that MVC framework to isolate the data and the model, and the view separately. I think that's what Rajagopal was talking about. So my workflows, I do have, either it's Mercurial or it's Git, it doesn't matter. We do have versioning control, but still the data is isolated as a model, as a representation, away from the view and the control logic. So it might be something to consider.
Yeah, we can throw more sophisticated science on it, but in the real world, you have to produce, you have to deliver, and you do it in a fast and efficient way. Even if it's not a theoretic, automated test procedure, work. You test all things on a sample thoroughly, and then you roll it out on all the other devices. And everything you test, you test before. In live environments, which we update and roll out changes, we cannot afford any mistake, because 3,000 passengers may complain that TV is not working, or phones are not working, or the safety system. 2,000 people want to go out for an excursion and they cannot swipe cards. Interface not working, making a big line. That's a problem. That's why we test all what we configure in the lab. And if it's working, we roll it out into a production environment.
One more question, everybody?
Just a comment that I've been working on text and trying to get SVG from it. You mentioned SVG. And text is, from what I can see, it is by far the most sophisticated graphics engine anywhere. But what do we get out from it? You get PDF out from it. You get text from it. But what you really want is SVG. With as much semantics, with as much links, or if you like, connection between the elements kept. So it's great to know that Tiltantau is working on a direct conversion. What you don't want to do is to go into PDF, then pull out you've lost all your a lot of the good things about text. So I don't know the guy, but if we can put any pressure on him to create this SVG, I think this is as big as tech when it first came out in my little mind.
Yes, I also need it urgently because this documentation, we and customers, we have web-based documentation, wikis, and so on. And if we would have SVG, we would have all the documentation native in our web browsers and not open a big fat Adobe Reader or any other PDF reader just for displaying it. I would love to have SVG at some time.
Thank you. going to switch the toggle a little bit. Boris is going to be next with making ACM styles.
And the marcher will be this afternoon.
Could you?
Yeah.
Okay. Okay.
No, yeah, just you could unplug this on the computer side. I don't need power. Yeah, if you could just plug it into VGA, it would be.
Yeah,
I understand that you don't have a HDMI at all.
No, that's my understanding as well. Did I do this right?
Probably. Don't know. Maybe you need to. Yeah, it looks like this is a proper polarity.
Yeah. Oh, it's the screw.
Yeah.
Okay, that's all. There we go. Yeah.
Okay. Oh, great. Okay. Just a quick question. Did anybody here have any paper published in ACM? Oh, thank you. And, well, ACM is one of the biggest, or as we say now, huge publishers of computing related materials. And as you see, even here, lots of people publish something there. They have something like 50 journals. They even could not tell me how many conference proceedings they call them. For some reason, they call them SIGs. They did not even tell me how many conference proceedings they publish. So it's very large, very big, very technical oriented publisher. And as it happens, they started working with tech from the beginning, from the very early ages of tech. And this is a good thing. We always love somebody who is an early adapter, but unfortunately, it's not. It has some drawbacks. Okay, I looked in some timestamps in all ACM styles, and you will see why I blacked everybody's name by mine. You will see shortly why did I do this. But what I want you to look at are dates. It says June 13th, and it says something like May 89, 93, but they actually reference some older styles, and I guess that the older code goes all the way back to 80s, to the middle 80s, to the very, very first ages of tech. And the problem is that nobody threw away anything. They just kept patching and patching and patching. And whenever they wanted to make any change, they took the old code, made a copy, and put a new name. So when I started to support it, I found that they have as many as 12 different classes. And as you see from the name, some of the classes like SIG Alternate 05015 is probably it's probably throwaway class, but they have no idea which ones were permanent, which were not. And they all have approximately same code with small changes and small aggravated changes. And if you think that bibliography was better, then here's BibTeX files for you. It's not 12, it's about 7 BibTeX files, but they use something else. And they all were official, and they were all very close, but a little bit different. It was. And if you think that the code there was good, I put here some comments from a user who is much more tech expert than I am, and it's going to be unnamed unless the user wants to be named here. And he said that he wrote me a couple of long letters about this. One letter was, okay, I looked, there are several packages copied verbatim in the style, and with packages, well, they were named, they were referenced, but the thing is that each of them finished with end input, so this copy was absolutely... and start section was redefined, and the way of redefining, they forgot to put something that as a new section name should not end in the column, and so you could have section name and column break, or section name or page break. And footnotes were, well, okay, and here is the epitome of this critic. I deleted some phrases here. So it was like this. This is an example of the code from another author, and it's in the journal code style, which basically says that declare option SEM to PC. To PC is the name of the journal. I think it's transaction of parallel computing. And says, okay, let's put SEM to PC true, which means that this journal. And they say, okay, but this is, by the way, it's not JACM. This is another journal. It's not another, and so about 40 times it says it's not this another journal. Then the next phrase was, what if you have JACM? It says, okay, it's JACM, this is JACM true, but it's not another. And by the way, can you see an error in this code? Because it was written a little bit earlier than 2PC code. It never says SEM to PC false. So it happens that this journal may be simultaneously JACM and 2PC journal. And by the way, this, since you have something like 40 journals for this style, you have 40 blocks like this in the code. And okay, a little bit about what I did, how I got in this mess. It was started really simple. I was asked to help them with some BibTeX updates. Then I was asked to do some maintenance for the concept system. It's basically like keywords, but very structured, very nice keyword. I started to do this. Then I started to change the copyright. And at some point after 2011, I found that I'm supporting something like a dozen of different styles with completely different ideas, but very close code, which was written by a dozen of people. Most of them never cared what anybody else wrote during the years. And it had problems, and one problem was that whenever I added something new, I ought to copy and paste it a dozen times, or even more if I wanted to change both LaTeX style and BibTeX style. So, and second problem was that I started to get a fan mail. I started to get letters which said, you know, this is very messy code. Did you write it? And what could I do? Because my name was there. And so it continued for several years. And at some point I said, okay, I want to do complete and full refactoring of the code. I want to make something completely new. And fortunately, it was very good time for this, because ACM editors got some complaints about about the design issues. Because I don't want to talk much about this, but if you looked, actually, in the letter I just quote, there was something about, if you looked at the old ACM from the design point of view, again, it was very nice design in the beginning, they started to change, patch, and so on. At the end, it looked horrible. So they wanted to change the design completely. And they said, by the way, I want to do code refactoring. They said, yes, let's do this simultaneously. So it was very nice thing, and I was lucky to have it in exactly proper time and proper place. So what happened? ACM editors did the design. I helped them a little bit. I still think it would be much better if they would hire several design companies, but I think it worked out very well. There was a company, many of you know, Aptara Incorporated, which did typesetting did metadata processing for them, so I worked in close cooperation with them, so my macros would work with their metadata tools, and I basically did tech stuff, and the idea was that I will do tech templates, and since ACM takes both tech and Word, Aptara takes my templates and converts them to Word. I don't know how did they do this, probably manually, doesn't matter. And that would be new ACM thing. Okay, the first and foremost design principle I wanted to do, I don't want to have what I had, I don't have this proliferation of styles. So just one code for all, or as Tolkien would say, I think I cannot say it in the correct Elvish, so I can say in English, one code for all and one code to bind them all and rule them all. No more different class options. So I took one DTX file, and my first idea would be, okay, I can generate several class files from it using different switches. And they said, no, I will not do this because somebody will copy my class file, rename it, and do something. So I have one class file, one which, and all my changes are inside this class file, and I really, really don't want. I said, I had a lot of interaction with the users, I will talk about this shortly, and I told them, you can ask me about anything, I will do, and I will try to accommodate you. The only thing I will not do some incompatible changes. Anything working in one journal should work for any other and any other conference. I just don't want proliferation. And one and another thing I wanted to do, the old ACM had a lot of quirks. Again, it's very old, and so the tables were a little bit different than anybody else's. So the table was a command rather than environment. The figures were a little bit different. Nothing. No, I'm not going to continue this. In the new ACM, I wanted as much standard LaTeX as possible. I'm a little bit ahead of myself. And I want this interface to be exactly same everywhere. So I basically wanted to tell them you can change ACM small to, for example, sigconf, and instead of a paper for a journal, you can have a paper for a conference. It should work. And as I said, and one of the consequences of this, you had 7 BibTeX styles. In the new ACM, only one BibTeX style. Fortunately, it's NetBib allows me to customize it. If you want, you can have numbers. If you want, you have offer year citation. But BibTeX file, BST, is exactly the same. And as I said, as much standard interface as possible, with one big exception. Offer information, I ought to rewrite the interface because, well, basically all publisher class changes the offer information anyway, so I ought to do it. Another thing, structured comments. From the beginning, I was working in cooperation with Aptara, which told me, okay, you have tech file. We want to be able to put this tech file through our scripts and get some metadata to put in our tables and to put publishers. Here is an example. As you see, this is acknowledgement section. And it says grant sponsor and lots of things, grant num. What happens is that when you go through the script, they would make a table of information about finances, which is necessary for some publication information, for other things, and so on. So basically, I put a lot of structure. You will see more of this when we talk about offer information. Okay, some new features. First, all the variations are optional to document class. So you have, for example, ACM small, which means ACM journal with a small page size. You have sigconf, which is the standard conference format. You can have even manuscript format, which is looks like a journal, but slightly different. You have some additional document class option, like review option. Right now, this option just numbers lines for communication between reviewer or editor and author. So you can say you have a problem with line 5 on your manuscript, line 12 on page 14 or something like this. Actually, for some customers, I did some elaborate thing with review. You can put on some editorial comments, which would be typeset as a margin notes and so on. Nobody asked me to do this for SEM. I didn't, but it's an interesting idea. Another option is anonymous option. And if you switch it on, it means that all the information, like offer information, affiliation, grant information, acknowledgments, will not be typeset, so you can send it to a reviewer for the thing. You have screen option, which will generate slightly different version for screen only thing and so on. A little bit about offer information. As you see, it's very structured. You have offer. You can put org ID, which is a system for identification of researchers. You can put affiliation, which has a lot of structures in itself. You have institution, street address, city, country, and so on. And again, you put it always, but journals usually don't use it. Conferences do partially, but Aptara MetaTools always use it. So it's things that you can do. You have a copyright system, and basically you put thing like set copyright, SEM copyright or US government, and it will print out the boilerplate copyright, which is correct, and which the lawyers department spent a lot of time writing exactly up to the copyright principles. You have so-called CCS system, which is basically keyword system, but very structured with a lot of, and actually you generate the CCS statement in the web page. So you click on the web, select your keywords, and will generate some tech code you just copy and paste. You have conditional typesetting, so you can say this is print only, and you can in print only say see our supplementary materials, and in screen only version you would put the actual supplementary tables, figures, and so on. It will work. You have some additional floats. You have think they wanted teaser figure, which is a special figure which goes just in the front matter. You have a lot of marginal figures which work with on the margins for some formats and so on. Okay, couple of words how I did this. I usually don't use GitHub. I'm an old timer and I just used to have my own version control system, but for this project I had I set up GitHub repository because the users wanted to be able to comment, and actually found out it's, I think, my third or fourth project in GitHub, and I really love the interface because you have, for free, you have backtracking, you have possibility to incorporate some other people, you have very nice version control system, I really like it. So to say the truth, I really liked GitHub and I really liked the organization. So, okay, samples. Here is a typical journal. This is ACM Small, a typical journal. As you see, it has, I can increase this thing, but I just want to show you the page, how does the page look. By the way, I don't want to talk much about graphical elements. I don't want to tell much about design because it was not my main job, but I just want to say that they changed the fonts. They used Libertine fonts for the body, and they used new TX fonts for the MAF, and thank you very much for the new TX. It was, you know, to say the truth, the old ACM, and especially ACM MAF, was ugly. I really love the way it looks now. It's much more readable, much better, much cleaner. While I'm just proud what we did with this. Okay, let me try to go back and back and
work for me, please?
Yeah, I little. Okay. Yeah. Here is your SEM talk. This is again journal, but as we see, it's a two-column journal with two-column printing. And again, same interface. You just change thing, and you go from this to this, which is CConf. It's the standard conference. I think I have put, I was too generous, I have put something like four different conference formats. Probably I could have less than this, because at the end I found that I was able to converge much of the styles and put them close, but still there are some subtle difference. And again, the thing is that whenever you do any change, you need to talk to the SIG committee, to the basically the organizing committee of the conference, and they have their own opinions about this. And the interesting thing is the front matter. As you see, you have as you see in the conferences, they have this number this. They have completely different way is of putting offers than in journals. They have these blocks, and in the old ACM it was a nightmare, because you ought to put number of offers manually, you ought to put breaks in the offer information manually, you ought to put manually how do you put them into the on the page, and so on. And in the new interface, you just put offers, and tech is smart enough to do it correctly for you. For this conference, by the way, what you see, it's interesting. You see that it's anonymous, so you have no information about the offers. Let me try to click it, maybe it will do. So you see that offer is anonymous. The information about offer is anonymous, and by the way, this was typeset with review option. Do you see this little red line numbers?
Wait.
A little bit. Okay, there. another interesting thing which I also liked, and I want to show you, it's completely different typesetting, and I cannot take credit because it was SIG-CHI conference committee, I just implemented this, but look how nicely do they use their margin. It's not two column typesetting, it's one column, but they put all the footnotes on the margins, they have margin figures and margin tables, and it's really very nicely done thing. And what I'm really proud of, that I was able to do this exactly the same thing. And by the way, this is wide figure. It's a figure which takes both margin. And since I have one column, I decided to reuse standard LaTeX figure and table asterisks thing. You have this start version of figure, which is two column in the standard LaTeX. But for me, it's a column plus margin. Very nice thing. So that's basically what I did for them. And now let me go back. Okay. Yeah. And now a little bit about my plans for the future. My first big plan, and I promised ACM to do it, is accessibility support. I want to be able to put things like tagged equation and tagged figures. I want to be make it compatible with the screen readers for blind people and so on. Unfortunately, and this is a plugin for the accessibility group, accessibility options for the options for creation of accessible PDF from tab is still in the state of developing. So if you can contribute or you can help with this, it would be absolutely great, because this is what we need to do from tech, and I'm going to plug it in. The second thing I'm thinking about, right now we support BibTeX and we support NetBib. I'm thinking about Bibliotech and Viber and all this. I did not do it yet, and I did not get a request from the users or six, but I guess at some point I will. So the second thing I would like to do. And now shout out to people who helped me. First, I'm grateful to ACM editors. They were really patient with me, and we moved the deadlines several times. It took much more time and much more effort than I thought it would do, and they were really good with me. It's Aptara, and I think we, some of you have seen some Aptara people. I remember Sihar from the tab in India, it was great, and they were helpful, and they were really straightforward what they need from me, and it was good. And a lot of people who tested it, several of them contributed code, and again, GitHub is very good for code contribution. A lot of them gave me a lot of interesting suggestions. And also, while I said some bad words about people who did ACM development for 30 years, still it was huge effort, and they did a lot of good work. And some ideas I took, some not. I probably didn't take much of their code, but I was careful in looking through their ideas. And it was just a huge project, and it was very interesting to do. So thanks to them too. And I probably should thank Barbara and all the developers of AMS code, because ACM is based a lot, actually import ACM Arc. Inside it's AMS Arc, inside it's actually AMS. With all the bugs of AMS, by the way. And a lot of new people, it was a huge endeavor. It was a huge endeavor making this work for 50 journals and dozens of components was immensely difficult, but it was rewarding. And I hope this is better than.
Thank you. Questions for Boris, or?
I have a couple of questions. First of all, Boris, is this supposed to deal with reprocessing old archives or just moving forward?
Moving forward, I don't think they have any plans. It would be absolutely, because interface changed. And I threw away a lot of old interface. Any reprocessing of old archive would be impossible, I think. Prohibitively impossible.
I'm also assuming that the classes itself are not public. Is that correct?
And not what?
The classes are not public.
Not?
Yeah, public. Like they're on CTEM, right?
No, they're on CTEM, they're public. One of the things I said, I want them to be on C10, I want the authors to work with them. So everything is on C10, not the latest version, because I want to incorporate some, or maybe I even put the latest on C10, but everything is on C10.
So they're not using proprietary fonts or anything?
No,
like
okay.
This.
It's interesting. The story is that they used fonts which were proprietary at the time. They used new school book and some other fonts, and they had an option to use proprietary fonts and so on. Then, at some point, these fonts became public, but they still were marked as proprietary. Now they moved to Libertine, which is free, to NewTX, which is free, and they have no plans to switch to proprietary anything in the future.
Dave?
Is this an optional input to the ACM, or does everybody have to use it?
As far as I understand, they're going to completely switch from the old tech classes to the new one. So you basically either use this or use the Word templates, which are based on this.
Say the last thing I didn't hear.
You use the Word template based on this.
Okay.
Yeah. Yes, they accept Word, and one of the things that Aptara did for us was that Aptara takes this and and makes Word templates as closely resembling this as possible.
Maybe one more, Christian?
I'm not sure about this.
So, for example, if author names contain Unicode characters,
I understand the question. I really don't know. This is better to. Their processing is done by Aptara, so this is a question for them, I'm afraid.
David?
Yeah, I was going to say that from my perspective, what I see a lot of students do is open up the ACM digital library and then they generate BibTeX from that and grab it and stick it into something like a BibDesk or some tool like that. Mm-hmm. So perhaps the need for BibTeX isn't so much there because there's so much BibTeX information that nobody attacks
a citation. Yeah.
By hand.
Yeah, BibTeX has a huge user base and legacy, and this is probably one of. But fortunately, BibLaTeX is compatible with BibTeX, right. So you can take BibTeX and process it with BibLaTeX.
Yeah, okay. Offer you a lot more.
Yeah.
Thank you, Boris.
Thank you.
I don't
or we
know.
Can go to lunch early, you know.
Yes, either or.
So our last speaker of the morning, Frank Middlebach from LaTeX. Oh, there it is. And so much more.
Okay, so, yeah, for the rest of the morning until lunch or until you get tired of what I'm talking about, I want to take you to Wonderland and have a look at how Alice is doing floating along with her pictures. So that's basically the idea. And let me see. I'm sorry for the resolution. It doesn't quite fit, so we have to do as best as we can. So, basically this is about typesetting Alice. And yesterday we saw those that were on the tour, they could see a very, very nicely typeset version of Alice in Wonderland. There's all kind of pictures. And I spoke with Tim afterwards, and he said it was a bitch to typeset. And that's actually why I choose it as well as an example source. But the reason why this is a bitch is stuff like this here. If anybody knows the text, yeah. It's basically a long piece of poem, if you like, which has to go on a single page. Really, to make it work well. So you have to have your pagination coming out in a way that this is going to happen. And well, it is likely not to. And that's basically what is going to happen if you try to what I did. I took the text from Project Gutenberg because it's long in the public domain. I did a little bit of turning it into a text source by adding section headings, changing a little bit of underscore into emphasis and stuff like that, but a fairly minimal amount of sort of pre-processing from the ASCII version that came from that. I also ensured that those kind of poems were considered a block, unbreakable block, and I hunted for the pictures, the original ones from the first edition, which are also on the web, downloaded them, edit them as figures in roughly the right places. And then I said, okay, let's try and typeset. So, oops, can you read this halfway, or should I try to get it a little bit bigger? Let's see how this works. This is probably too big in latest, we will see. Okay, so basically the style I used was two column, really for testing, to have small columns. No widows and orphans, so a hard requirement on the text. I asked LaTeX to favor to put the headings on top of columns, basically by making that a very attractive place to break a page or a column. And I told it to basically try to keep some text in front of those poems, not 100% request, but something like very encouraging. So taking this, we can run it through LaTeX, and I did this. What you obtain is basically a bunch of issues in your resulting document. So here it is. I'm not sure how well you can see everything, but I think on the whole you can see sort of roughly what is going on. First page, the rabbit is already having huge amount of space, typical LaTeX way of dealing with figures. If we go on, this looks kind of okay. This looks kind of okay. It's too a little bit strange with the dots as the end of the chapter being on top of the column. Another one of those bad figures. This is okay. This has a little bit too much space on below the figure. This is again too much space in front of the heading. And now this. Now this is really not what you want to see in your typeset book. And why? Well, here we are. So it just came out as I thought it would come out. And so this is a problem. If you go through this, you see a couple of more problems. This is again one of those. This is a nice one. See the left column on the bottom? A lot of empty space. Why? Well, here is a paragraph with three lines, meaning no break. Because of widows and orphan settings, so it didn't fit in the two lines that were left down here, so you end up with this setting. And you can go on, you find more of those, more empty, shortened columns because of orphans like here. Anyway, enough of this. So can we do better? Oh yes, by the way, those who do not want to actually listen to the talk, you can look at those little notes saying this should be done in 5 minutes so that you can count up and tell me out if I'm getting out of sync with that. As I did when I did the first iteration of that talk in Bachotec, I talked for 1.5 hours on a slot of 1 hour throughout the whole break or something. So I'm not trying to do this time. You can do it. It means a lot of manual labor. You have to look at your source, you find this problem on page whatever it was, 8, with this lot of white space. You look at all the previous pages, you think, okay, maybe I can make a break here, move this over. If you're the author of your book, you might even say, okay, maybe I rewrite this paragraph and make it a one line shorter or something. If you're not the author, that is not really an option, but you might reformat your paragraph. You might think of doing other stuff like making the page one line longer or shorter to fit a problem 5 pages down the road. All in all, it means a lot of iterations, a lot of manual work, and it clutters your source with problems that you can't reuse it if you want to change something else in terms of style. So how long do you think it takes for Alice to do this kind of work, to get it into better shape?
5 minutes. Couple of days.
Less than 2 minutes. plus the 25 years thinking about this kind of problem. But that's a different story. Okay, so let me try to show that to you. Oops, so let me go and find a... So this is now running a script, because this is still prototyping. Maybe I'm showing you the script later on. But basically, you will see its tech. So let's run this and have a little bit of thought. And here we are. So this is the version that came out in 7 seconds. It's not perfect. We are talking about this later on. But here we go. There's the rabbit. This is now a double spread. You can see both pages, left and right. This is the next one. This is the next one. Here we see where we got our text in on the double spread, and so on and so forth. You could think of some things could be done better in terms of spacing, in terms of spacing as well as possibly figure placement. But on the whole, you end up with a document that looks reasonable. Okay, so I'm in the middle of doing a demo, so I have to go back here. That's the problem. Okay. Yeah, this is the document I just showed that it actually gets produced. So how was this done? First, let's move back to see a few more examples. Oops, no, this is exactly what I hope didn't happen with this kind of control. Here we are. Good. I took a couple more documents to play with this kind of stuff, and all from Gutenberg. This is now just text. And I made it a little bit different than the Alice I showed you before. I used the standard LaTeX way of allowing a little bit flexibility between paragraphs. So 0 point parse skip, but plus 1 point of change. If you do this, all four documents have problems. They either produce something above 4,000, 6,000 badness in vertical spacing, that's the first number here, or they produce 10,000, in other words, infinitive, like really big spaces on the pages. So you see something between 4 and 16%. If you go more drastic, like saying there's no paragraph skip variation, you have up to 40% of your pages are being bad, if you just take text. So that's the situation if you just go default LaTeX algorithm for page breaking. So go out here. What's the idea? Well, basically, TeX has a very nice algorithm for paragraph breaking. We know it is globally optimizing the paragraph. Now, a paragraph has typically about 30 breakpoints in a line. Well, plus minus, depending on the wording and the size of the lines. But a typical line has this amount of breakpoints. A page has about 40, 45, 50 lines of text, which means there's also a similar amount of breakpoints. A paragraph has, I don't know, 5 lines, 10 lines, if you have long paragraphs, depending on the authors, 20 lines. And a chapter, which typically starts a new page, also has something like typically 10, 20, 30, 40 pages. So again, it's a similar kind of operation. So it should be reasonable to assume you can adapt this algorithm for line breaking in a way to make it page breaking compatible. So that's the idea. So question, Do I need to recap how this algorithm is going to work? Or you all understand, you remember what is said in the tech book and the program? Anybody not? Okay. So let's try and make it quickly through this. Basically, the algorithm has dynamic programming as the method to work. And what does this mean? To be this kind of technique to be applicable, you have two requirements as a minimum. There's possibly some other reasons why you can't use it, but these two requirements are really important. One is, if I have an optimal solution for the whole problem, any sub-problem is also optimal for its part of the problem. So in other words, if I have a pagination that is optimal according to some criteria, and I look at the pages 1 to 5 of it, then the solution, the sub-solution that is in the full solution, is optimal for this part, page 1 to 5. And this is true for all of those sub-problems. That's a requirement. You have to have this kind of situation to make this coding technique, algorithmic technique, applicable. And the second is that you actually, if you look at all possible solutions, you would recompute the same kind of sub-problems over and over again. And that's true for something like page breaking, because if you look at finding, say, how to do the first page in the best possible manner, and you have a solution for this, then how the others are, there could be many, many solutions where the first page just stays as it is, and the same is for all others. So you're repeating these kind of sub-problems. How do you do page 5 to page 6 in the same way? These two are sort of key. And you can reformulate that. If I look at a breakpoint somewhere ending a certain column, then it doesn't matter how I reach this breakpoint, in other words, how the first pages have been produced, as far as anything after it is coming is concerned. So once I found the best way to come to this point, it doesn't conflict with what I'm looking in on the next pages. That's key for this situation, and this is basically the first requirement. And if we do this, yeah, as I said, they are then independent. So I only have to remember the best way to come to this position. I don't care about all the other ways that I could do page 1, 2, 3, 4, 5. I keep the best, and all the other pages that I'm trying to find the best solution, 6, 7, 8, 9, are not depending on how I did the first 5, other than ending up exactly in this point. I talk here about additional conditions. If you read this, the question, of course, is what is this? What kind of additional conditions are there? And basically, if we are dealing with floats or other nice complexity things, then we have to be very careful that this optimality principle is still applicable. And therefore you get additional conditions to make it sure that the independence between part of the solution and the rest is valid. And we see this a little bit later. Okay, so having that as a sort of abstract technique description, the algorithm that Don did for line breaking and what we can sort of reuse for, Michael Plus actually did with Don as the supervisor for his PhD. The algorithm is known as Knuth Plus, but I think it should be correctly known as Plus Knuth. We can describe it like this. We have the document, We want to paginate it. It has breakpoints after lines and after other elements. We go through all those breakpoints one by one. And what we maintain is what is called an active list. And these active list elements, they represent the best way to reach a certain point in the document that we have so far found. That's the way to think about it. And initially, the only active list element that we have is the beginning of the document. So there's just one element. And then we go through the breakpoint list, and we try to form from the current breakpoint that we're looking at to each of those elements in the active list, we try to form a column out of this material between active list point and the current breakpoint. If that can be done, in other words, there's the quality function says, okay, this is a good column if you try to do this, and it's not saying, oh, you have just two lines and the rest of the page is empty. If you can do this, then we call this a candidate for the next column. And then, if we've done it to all elements in the active list, we look at the best of those solutions, and we remember that by adding it to the active list. So the active list is growing slowly with new or found solution, partial solutions. And if we have additional conditions, then we might have to keep to add more than one. If for each of the different conditions, we have to add one additional best solution. If we have no additional conditions, then we just have to add one, basically. So this grows, and in the opposite direction, if we find that the distance between one active list element and the current breakpoint is so big that the material between the two can never be squeezed into a single column, it's just too much. We say this active breakpoint is no longer of interest, therefore we put it away, it becomes inactive, so to speak. And this way the stuff is shrinking again. And by the end of the day we reach the document end, we take the best solution for the last break, which is the document end, and then we work backwards through the solutions, how we reach them, and this actually gives us the optimal solution for the whole document. So needs a bit of housekeeping, but essentially that's the algorithm's work. And if the complexity is really two loops, if you think about what I just said, one is the outer loop. So it's a number of breakpoints. So if that is the outer loop, the inner loop is essentially the length of the active list. And so if the average length of the active list is bounded by a constant, it cannot get bigger than, I don't know, 50, whatever it is, then we have an algorithm that runs in linear time in the length of the document, because breakpoints are basically limited in numbers. You will have as many as you have lines, basically, in a column. If it's unbounded, you have a quadratic function, so it gets the longer the document, the faster it becomes slower, basically. So yeah, that's where you are. So, having said that, can we apply CNUS Plus to our problem? As it turns out, we can, but it doesn't really help. That's the same four documents I spoke about earlier. And you see, if I the second line is basically always saying where set base is applying the optimal solution technique, trying to find one. And in most cases, it doesn't find a solution. It runs out of options to optimize. And the reason why this is the case is a line in a paragraph has a lot of flexibility. All the white space can be squeezed and stretched. A page or a column has usually nearly no flexibility because the lines are fixed. There is a line break possible, but you cannot stretch the baseline scape. You can, but typographers will tell you off in most cases. So that's the reason why we end up like this. Only Jane Austen was something you actually came out nicely. Okay, so what are we going to do yet next? Basically, you have to add flexibility or give up. Now, there are four options, or maybe more, but the four I think are the most viable ones. The first one is you change your textual elements. Now, in most cases, like a novel, that's not a good idea. So if you change the paragraphs around, people will not get too happy, unless it's one of those old first adventure game books where you jump from page to page, you have options, and it says go to page 51 if you decide to open that door in the dungeon. Okay, but this is not what you can do in a normal novel. You can do it in maybe journals. If you have individual articles, you can change them, reorder them, but only on that level. The other three are possibilities to add flexibility. The first is we can allow to change column heights. So we can make all columns of a page, or rather of the double spread, two pages, left and right, we can then make them one line longer. If you do this, and you do it carefully, and the paper is thick enough that you don't look through and see that the other pages are shorter, you can actually get away with this kind of thing without readers noticing. So you get flexibility by adding one line or shortening. The second possibility is you can rewrite your text as an author. I did that quite a lot in my books when it didn't come out nicely. And the best example is Jean-Luc, his book, all the text is in rectangles. I mean, he must have rewritten it. There's no other way to get to this. But if you're not the author, there's still a possibility because you can try to reformat the paragraph, making it one line longer, making it one line shorter. Tech actually has this ability called looseness, and you could try to do this. The last one was floats, and this is the sort of topic of the talk. But just to give you a short thing, as I said, making something shorter or longer on two pages side by side is a typical trick of the craft. I mean, that's one way to get things sorted out if it's complicated. If we try to use the looseness stuff, that's not really good because the tech implementation is naive. If you ask it to make the paragraph one line longer, it happily hyphenates the last word and put a bit of it on the next line says done. So you have to work a little bit harder to make this possible. It is possible, and I actually implemented that, so you get this kind of flexibility, but you can't use looseness directly. If we go through this, and we see that the optimality principle of the dynamic programming is kind of changing, and you have to add conditions. The first situation is, and this is the best you can hope for, all your pages, all your columns have the same height, or at least after a certain number of pages, that's the case. If that is the situation, then your algorithm runs linear time. If, on the other hand, all the pages or columns can vary in height because you have a strange design which says page 50 is actually a little bit shorter, or whatever reason you want to have this kind of strange thing, if it's not all the same after a certain point, then you actually have the bad situation, you end up in quadratic time. And that's sort of the worst you can get in this kind of algorithm here. And so it gets really slow if the document gets long. If we run pages long or short, it's still linear. The actual factor gets worse. It gets worse by basically 3 times the number of columns you have on a spread. So if you have 2 columns, means 4 columns on a double spread, then it goes with a factor of roughly 12 slower than if you're not doing this kind of thing, because you have the line shorter, the line normal size, or the line longer, so 3, and you have to remember in which column your current breakpoint, which column your current breakpoint ends. The reason is that the next column needs to have the same length addition or shortage. Only if you start a new page or a new double page, you are free to choose. In all other cases, you have to use the same value. Therefore, there's a dependency on following pages. So you have to remember them and make them different solutions, basically, or different partial solutions, basically. Okay, so if you change the paragraph lengths, 4 lines to 5 lines or something like this as a technique, then again, it stays linear, but the factor is noticeable, depending on how many of those paragraphs can actually vary. Typically, what I found is it is going between 10 and 50, but there is a different, more complicated formula to actually say how the complexity changes. If we have floats, good question. The complexity calculation is very complicated. If you have many floats or many, many places where you can place floats, on top, on bottom, maybe differently, spanning floats, all kind of things, then the situation gets pretty bad very soon. Basically, the complexity factor that gets into this is something having to do with factorials. So it's kind of factorial of the number of areas you can place with times the factorial of the number of floats waiting to be placed. So you have to keep that somehow down. We will see how to do this. Okay, if we just apply those techniques of enlarging the page or rewriting the paragraph in terms of how many lines it becomes, then our examples all time nicely. They find the algorithm is finding optimal solution if you apply either of the additional flexibilities, except in the Alice in Wonderland, because of this bloody tail of the mouse. You actually have to add both variation flexibility possibilities to come to a solution. But all the others, one or the other flexibility addition is enough to make the document typeset properly and finding an optimal solution. So this is all without floats still. So adding floats. This guy is going to help us, so I put him on. If you want to add floats to your document, or you have floats in your document, then there are certain rules that should be obeyed, and certain rules that you want to obey as best as you can. The first two are more or less a requirement. You want to have your floats in order as they are numbered, in order as they appear in some sense in the document. There are very few situations where this is not the case. I mean, some journals they are placing figures and tables according to aesthetic situations and replacing them all over the place. But it's very, very uncommon. Normally you want to have figure one coming up before figure two, figure three, and so on. So that's kind of a hard requirement. Also, typically you do not want to have the float coming before the first point where it is being talked about in the document, or the main point where it's being talked about in the document. It's rather the main call-out. In LaTeX, we do this typically just by placing the float in the right point, position, and that defines this call-out. So LaTeX will never put a float a page earlier than where it is. So it allows typically to put the float on top of the same page, but it is not moving it to a page or two earlier. So that's another kind of hard requirement. And then what we wish for is that you can see the float from where it is being talked about, so that people do not have to search for it. But not always, that's not always possible. I mean, if you have many things, many floats you talk about, they may have to go later. But if they are not being placeable at this point, they should come typically as soon as possible, so that people have a way to find them easily and getting not too much distracted. So the question is, given those kind of rules, and there are some others depending on sort of aesthetic and design criteria, what is the way to define the quality of your placement? How do you define this is a good placement, this is a very good placement, this is a really bad placement? And that's not very easy. The approach that I took, and you can't read it because I made it too big, but maybe now we have to move a little bit smaller. My approach was to say, then if I have to turn the page to find the float, that's not so good. If I have to turn more, that's even less good. So let's just count how many turns I have to make before the float comes. And for each turn, I add some kind of penalty, demerits in tech terms, to my quality function, so saying this is not so good. If
it's always on the spread.
If it's on the spread, it's empty, that's okay. If it's not on the spread, it is starting to get less good. That's the idea.
But it could be anywhere on the spread.
We come to restrictions on this, but if the design allows for anywhere, then it is okay. If the design allows only for after, then it will be implemented only after. If the design allows for the typical LaTeX version, it can be on the same column, then that's the restriction. But as far as demerits is concerned, that is the way I make the situation, sort of the quality being considered not so good or considered being better. The issue that we have with float placement is that if I place a float, then the column height changes, right? Possibly two columns change if it's a spanning float, but the columns change. And if the columns change, then my line breaking pagination is different, because it breaks in a different place. Obviously, we have less lines to put in the first column. And that means I essentially, for each placement, I have to do the whole textual optimization separately. So they are input to the whole process. And that means if there are too many that needs to be looked at, right? So as I said earlier, the more areas you have, the more floats are not being placed, the bigger the number of placements that you could think of abstractly will be there. Therefore, the factor in this sense is going up enormously. So we have to find a way to prune those out, those solutions that are definitely do not make aesthetically or whatever sense. I mean, why should I wait for three pages if I have a possibility to place a float and then suddenly place one that was three pages earlier? I mean, typically we would say this is not a good design because the user has to turn unnecessarily to find this graphic or whatever, while we have space to actually put it and next to its description. So there are designs that are considered probably not very good, and we have to get rid of them as soon as possible because we don't want global optimization with all those things that we never ever going to actually choose in the end. The problem, of course, is if we drop too many up front, we might end up with no solution whatsoever. And in fact, depending on the document, you may have to have different kind of strategies, what things could be thrown out or to what extent the layouts could be thrown out. To give some examples, one way is to say we don't want to defer too many floats. So if we have a solution which has 10 floats deferred, we're not going to consider it. That's kind of nice as long as you don't have somebody saying, look at table 1 to 25. And then all the main call out is 25 tables in a single line. Now, most documents will do then, I don't know, let's say 2 tables per page as best. So you're ending up with at least 10 pages or something to get rid of this particular situation. Now, if I say never defer more than 5 floats, this document will not typeset. No way. And same with the others. So you have to come up with some sort of balance between the typical situation and the extreme case. You want to be able to typeset both, but you don't want to delay or make the typesetting processing time for the majority of the documents very, very long, just because you consider all kind of weird solution in case that it is necessary for the 5% of strange documents. So one way to look at this is it needs further research. Another way to look at it is you try with something which is reasonable for most documents which you find by experiments. If you run out of options, you say, okay, this document is not in this class, you give a little bit more flexibility in terms of keeping more of the slightly more weird, considered more weird placements, and hope for it again, run it again and hope for the best, and if that doesn't work, you give even more possibilities. So those documents that are really complicated, they run several times, if you like, with more options, and then take a very long time to finish, but the majority works. Okay. Interfaces, what I've implemented is setting up spreads, setting up float areas in various places on the page. The callout constraints I talked about already when Boris asked. So you have these kind of different things. You define how many columns you have, how the height of the column is. That's the trick I used on the first page, really. I said the first spread has a dropout on the left side. And that's why it came out nicely with the rabbit on the right side. So that was a bit cheating. That's for the spreads. You can have several of them. The floats have how many floats can go in this area, how is the area affecting the columns and stuff like that. That's the color constraints. I have these four. The last two are available in current LaTeX. Column is the default, and if you use the FL after package, then you get a requirement that the float comes really after the callout, so it goes in the next page or next column. So this is there. And then I'm currently playing around with manual options. So you have the algorithm doing all kind of placement that you that it thinks it is best according to your criteria. If you don't like it, you can say, okay, but this should go one page later or something, and you give it an exact spot. And then the algorithm works around it, making everything optimal, but keeping that particular requirement as part of it in the solution. So that's a bit experimental, as everything, really. So, framework. To make this all work, I developed a framework. I spoke about that in Bachotech. That was the first part of it. The idea here is, and I will this make this very short, is basically to have something to experiment with these kind of things. That's my main reason I came up with the initial one. It uses LuaTeX. And I implement the optimizing algorithm, the dynamic programming stuff in Lua outside of tech, basically, if you think about it. It is in Lua tech, so it's in tech because the Lua interpreter is inside Lua tech, but it is not using any macros or something. It goes completely to the Lua side. The consequence of doing it the way I did it is it does actually work with out of the box, if you can call it this, with every kind of major standard tech distribution, because LuaTeX is in the tech distribution, and it doesn't require anything else. So it can be run with Tech Live or something else. It can also run with something different than LaTeX. I mean, it could be running with a different format. There are some dependencies, but they are minimal, so you could make it run with a different format. And it essentially has four phases. First phase is run the document to resolve all the generated text, like table of contents, because that obviously plays into the material that you try to paginate. Of course, if you do this beforehand, then and you haven't done the pagination, the values in terms of page numbers and so on are not really 100% correct, which is why LaTeX runs several times as well doing these kind of things. So there is a certain up and down in this, and you can have impossible documents in the sense that they never ever have a valid solution. But that's kind of a different topic and different talk. Second phase is I take the galley information that tech is producing, like this text is turned into a paragraph of five lines or whatever. Here is a certain space between two paragraphs. This information I collect and build an abstract representation of the document externally in a file with all information that I need to do pagination. So it's a fairly short file given a normal tech document, so it gets rid of all the kind of details that are no longer necessary. But it is done by running tech and producing galleys, or by actually producing pages, but conceptually just producing the long galley. So all this information is there and converted in an abstract form. And then this is something like an afterthought phase 2B. I use this to separate the float information, but I could kept it in the same place. Phase 3 is the heart of the algorithm. It is doing the optimization, taking the input that comes out of phase 2. So you have this abstract document, which could actually be produced by a different program. It could be done by Word. If you could look at what Word is producing as far as columns is going and create the abstract representation, feed it into this algorithm, and the algorithm will give you as a result a list of places where the document should be paginated. So phase 4 is then taking this result, giving it back to tech and saying, okay, you have your source code, you can do whatever you like in terms of typesetting, but here are the places where you should end your columns. And then the last phase is actually producing your PDF or whatever the output of tech is going to be. So this is this. And if you know the paragraph breaking algorithm in tech, you know that with tech 3, Don added an emergency stretch. And you can think of applying the same approach to pagination. So you could have the following idea. If we run out of optimizing